Hey guys, what's up and welcome to this video where we are going to build my first ever home backup and cloud server using some parts that I've had from previous builds as well as some few new parts. Now there are a large number of reasons why building your own home server might be interesting for you. For example, privacy and control over your data. Obviously, if you don't have a third party involved, then nobody can steal your data. You might be interested in backing up your data. For example, I have a whole bunch of terabytes worth of data that I basically don't have a backup from, and I am in desperate need to somehow back up that data. You might want to be able to access all of your data across your network without having to set up the Windows shared folders all the time when you boot up your computer. Now, obviously, I could also just buy a NAS and have that running. However, first of all, these NASs that have, for example, four bays are insanely expensive. And second of all, I don't have full control over what I can actually do with the NAS. And because I'd like to run this also as a web server for some of my own web apps, having a NAS just doesn't cut it. More relevant for this case is probably that you want to build your own cloud server. So you want to kind of build your own Google Drive on your own machine at home and then be able to access all of your data wherever you are. Obviously, building your own server then also comes with the advantage of being able to upgrade it in terms of storage, and that having a few terabytes of space is much cheaper if you have it in your own machine and your own drive compared to, for example, getting a very expensive Google Drive subscription. And last but obviously not least, building and maintaining your own home server comes with a huge amount of things that you have to learn how to do. For example, setting up your home server, setting up Linux, running the cloud server, running your web server, getting it all accessed from the internet. It comes with a huge amount of interesting things that you can learn, a huge amount of probable errors that you can do. So I'm by no means an expert in the topic, and if I mess up something royally, then definitely let me know in the comment section below. So if you're interested in any of these topics, then definitely stick around, as I will be dedicating an entire video series to, first of all, picking out the parts for my own server, how I build it. Then we're gonna look at how to install Linux, how to set up a web server, how to set up a cloud server, how to set up backups on my computer, and finally also how to set up a password manager. But before all of that, this video is brought to you by no other than you guys, the viewers, and obviously me. Now, this channel is kind of my creative outlet. It's kind of my hobby, so to speak. I obviously have a full-time job next to what I'm doing here on my YouTube channel, and therefore all of the videos that you're seeing on my channel almost exclusively are pretty much paid and sponsored by myself and because I'm interested in some sort of topic. So if you do like this kind of content, and if you like me not having these annoying sponsored ads in the beginning of every video, you know them, it's kind of, this video is brought to you by insert random tech company. See them on pretty much any channel these days, and personally, I don't really like them too much. I just skip over them usually. But if you want to support my channel, then please hit that like button and consider subscribing for more content like this. But without any further ado, let's finally hop into the components that I've picked for my first ever home server. Disclaimer, I am not associated nor sponsored by any of the brands that I'm showing in this video. So the goal of today's video and build is to show you guys how simple it is to recycle old components from previous builds for a new home server. So we're going to start off with the CPU, which in my case is going to be an i7-3770K. This is a 4-core CPU with 8 threads, and I can run it at around 4 GHz, no problem. And this is obviously quite overkill for a home server, but this is what I've had lying around from not the previous build, but the actually 2 builds ago I was using this CPU. And if you want to build your own home server, then of course just using a dual core CPU or a quad core CPU without hyperthreading is also more than good enough. Now, because this CPU is an LGA 1155 CPU, we are restricted to using DDR3 memory, but thankfully I still had some 32 gigabytes of DDR3 memory lying around by HyperX, which is a kit that's only running at 1600 megahertz, but for the purpose of a home server, having a high number of gigabytes is definitely more welcome than having it run very fast. Now, frankly, only having 16 gigabytes would also be sufficient. Basically, you want to have about 1 gigabyte per terabyte of storage space. Now, before you guys are going to get your pitchforks out, I am well aware that this specific RAM is not ECC registered RAM. And I know that everybody in the world and on YouTube is probably gonna lose their minds over the fact that I'm building my own home server without using ECC memory. But hear me out. I've had a CPU and 32 gigs of RAM lying around at home. I'm not going to go out and buy an expensive CPU, motherboard and RAM combination only to have ECC memory. Now, for those of you who don't know what ECC memory is, it basically prevents the memory from corrupting your data. So what goes into the memory is also going to come out of the memory. And basically what can happen without ECC registered memory is that your data might be corrupted. So something you're saving on your hard drive is getting corrupted and therefore the file is not accessible anymore. Now, while this might sound very scary, in my opinion, if you're running a backup server where you have the data anyways on another computer, running ECC memory is a bit of a waste of money. And obviously, if I would build another server or if I would build a production server for a company, for example, then yes, definitely go for ECC memory. But in the case of just building your own home server or basically your first server, having ECC memory is a bit of an overkill in my opinion. All right, so with having said that, let's go back to the parts. Now, I also already had 2 4-terabyte Seagate hard drives. And when it comes to hard drives, then the only thing you really should take into consideration is that the hard drive is of the NAS standard. And that basically just means that the hard drive is made such that it can withstand 24/7 operation, which is obviously what you want to have it run in a home server. And finally, I still also had a 500GB Samsung SSD laying around, which I'm going to be using for the operating system, so for Linux, as well as the web server. Obviously, you don't really need an SSD for a home server, but having one for the web server is definitely a good idea. Next, let's have a look at the parts that I specifically bought for this home server. First in line is going to be another 8TB Seagate hard drive, which then totals our entire cloud space to 16TB. Try to get that with Google Drive. Since in the beginning, we are not going to implement a RAID volume. Now, I know I can hear you guys complaining why you're not implementing a RAID volume. Basically, same reasons as why I'm not going for the ECC memory is that this is only going to be a backup server where I have all the data at least on one PC at all times. Now, down the line, I will definitely implement a RAID volume on this server, but to begin with, we're just gonna go with some normal drives. Now, the amount of space that you need is obviously very much depending on your use case scenario. You might not need to be able to back up 16TB of data at all, so you could just start with 1 4-terabyte hard drive and be perfectly fine. So this very much depends on your specific needs. As motherboard, I bought the ASRock Z77 Pro 4M Micro ATX, which is obviously an LGA 1155 motherboard. It has 4 RAM slots, which is something that you should really consider when buying a motherboard for a home server, that you have at least 4 RAM slots to be able to upgrade to, well, at least 32GB of RAM. This motherboard also comes with 8 SATA connector, meaning that I can connect up to 8 hard drives off the get-go without having to buy an expensive SATA PCIe extension card. And finally, this motherboard also has DVI and HDMI outputs, allowing me to use the integrated GPU on the i7-3770K. Now, when looking for a case, you definitely want something that you can fit into the space where you want your home server to stand. It should be relatively silent, so if the insides are padded, that's definitely a good thing. And finally, you want to have as many hard drive bays as possible. Now, in my case, I'm going to be using the Fractal Design Define Mini, which is a micro ATX and mini ITX case. It has these kind of padded panels on all of the sides, so it's going to be a super silent case in production. It has 6 3.5-inch hard drive bays and 2 external bays where you can also put in some hard drives, meaning there is a total of 8 spaces for hard drives in this case, making this the perfect case for a small form factor and silent home server. For cooling, I went with the Legrand Macho RT by Thermalright, which is a very efficient cooler that I think you could even run without a fan, but when run with a fan, loudness is also kept very low. And finally, I bought a 400W Seasonic fanless PSU, which is, well, first of all, obviously completely silent, it has a platinum rating, so it's very efficient, and it should definitely provide enough juice for our home server. Now, obviously, because this is going to be a server primarily, I'm not going to be needing a GPU in this installation. Maybe you're going to need a GPU to first set up the motherboard, just keep that in mind, and to switch over to the internal GPU on the CPU. But in general, I'm not going to be using a GPU in this case. On the other hand, I want to invest in a 10 gigabit Ethernet adapter in the future, allowing me to connect my main computer to the server directly over 10 gigabit LAN. So, because I already had the CPU, RAM, SSD, as well as two hard drives from previous builds, the total cost for this build only amounts to about $500, which is obviously much less than if you were to go for an expensive Google Drive subscription, or if you went out of your way and rented a dedicated server by a hosting company or a virtual private server. Now, obviously, your mileage may vary, and depending on the parts that you have, your cost might be a little bit higher or even a little bit lower. But that about sums up the basics of how to build your own home server. Definitely tell me in the comment section below if you also want to build your own home server, if you already had to build one, and what your experience has been. In the next part, we're going to go over how to actually put everything together, and then we're going to be looking at installing Linux, as well as a few applications. But until then, thank you very much for watching, have a wonderful day, and I will see you guys in the next video.